it's a pleasure to be back here and see how well you're doing, Jeremy. And I've gotten to know Dr. Kent over the last year or so, and we've had some interesting conversations, and it's so great to see that this institution is under the leadership during critical times of a man with his talents. It really, you're fortunate, because a lot of changes are going on, and it's good to have someone at the helm that is facile and taking care of those things. I want to start here. I got to have the, where's the device here? I have to work over here, I guess. I titled this Understanding the Esophagus in the 21st Century, because it's changing from what it used to be, how we used to manage the esophagus, and particularly reflux disease. Now, believe it or not, this is a quote, and a lot of these people are my friends, really my good friends, and this is from Alan Cameron. How many people know Alan Cameron? He's from the Mayo Clinic. He's a gastroenterologist, and he's done more sort of a gastrological, epidemiologist, Alan Cameron. This is, I would say, the philosophy of GERD in the 20th century, and it's published. And here it is. The place of anti-reflux surgery or medical treatment in Barrett's esophagus is to relieve symptoms and esophageal inflammation without any expectation that the risk of adenocarcinoma will be reduced. The mission statement is symptomatic therapy. Well, all that's changed in just this short period of time since we crossed into the new century, because of technology, and the technology that's come up is the ablation of Barrett's. And so now you see there's a movement in gastroenterology to get rid of Barrett's, where before they didn't really focus on that, as you see here. And so there is a new kind of inspiration in the GI people, and there may be some GI people here, that Barrett's is important. Before they tolerated it, I would say to them, aren't you worried about getting Barrett's? Well, who knows, Dom, it's going to be okay. You know, what are you going to do about it in a way? And, you know, so forth. I said, well, you know, it goes to cancer. And they say, yeah, but, you know, it's only half a patient in, a year. So they have to have, you know, maybe, you know, it's trivialized, really. It's not a big deal. Well, that's all changed now, because now when I see them, I say, why are you ablating this patient? And they'll say, well, Barrett's leads to cancer. And all of a sudden, the interest in cancer is increasing. So this is changing. The whole concept of treatment of gastroesophageal reflux disease is changing. And so I'm going to try to talk to you about how we fit into that as surgeons. Now, this disease started, in order to do that, I want to make two more comments before I leave this, is that with that previous statement about how we should manage reflux disease, not giving any concern about Barrett's, was not very successful, because we weren't doing very well. Reflux disease increases by 30% in its incidence every 10 years. And it's getting, and you know, the complications of this disease is getting going up dramatically, particularly in the neoplastic side. And so when you look at heart disease, or you look at you look at cancer, improvements are being made. But in this disease, which is one of the biggest diseases we got, we're not making it at all. And it's time that the GI guys and the surgeons start focusing on this, because the public is expecting us to do something about it, and we're the guys that can do something about it. And we need to take this on and get this done. So now let's get back and let me put it into perspective for you for a little period of time here, so you understand where we're at, how we got to where we are, and what we got to do. Now this disease really started back in 1929 by this fellow right here. Most people don't know him. Chevalier Jackson. Now Chevalier Jackson was an ENT professor at Jefferson, and he collected information. He collected the information from Germany in regards to endoscopy by Kussmaul. He's the guy, you remember Kussmaul breathing and so forth. He collected information, kind of coupled that with Tom Edison's work with a light bulb and so forth, and got light down into the esophagus and started to do a great job of esophagoscopy. And he wrote a classic article in JAMA here, 1929, and proved that reflux disease, which caused ulcers in the esophagus, occurred in people who were alive. Before that time, they thought that was all changes that occurred after you died. Digestion of your organs, so to speak, from your own juices. And he showed that there was these inflammatory changes in live people and started the whole concept of reflux disease. Little teeny disease at that time, but now it's the most common foregut disease in the world. Now, that's good. Now, I want to just to have you see this closure of his article here in this publication in JAMA. Now, he says, of the various ulcerative diseases of the esophagus, one kind has been termed peptic because of its close similarity to postmortem aspects to that of peptic ulcer in the stomach. All the recorded cases are based on a diagnosis made only at autopsy. But the development of an esophagoscope to the degree of perfection that permits examination of the esophagus in any patient in a few minutes without any anesthetic or general or local has rendered practical the study of and the diagnosis of this disease in the living and has rendered its local treatment quite simple. Now here's the thing. Therefore, it may be said that a new era has begun in the study of this disease. And this excited people. And it excited the surgeons particularly, because we thought that if we could rearrange the anatomy in the area of the hiatus, we could stop reflux disease. No one ever heard of a sphincter at this time. You couldn't see anything down there anatomically. So everyone thought it was a geometry type of problem. And so we got surgeons involved in trying to make flap valves, which were not very physiologic. And we got the names like Nissen and Belzy and so forth, arise, Allison and so forth. These were all focused on rearranging the anatomy because they thought it was unique, this relationship of anatomy, to establishing a barrier between the stomach and the esophagus. Now, that was a long time ago. That was before we even knew there was a sphincter. It was like 50 years ago. And you know what? You're still doing the same operation today. You're 50 years behind time. So it's time we modernize and we start thinking about our approach to this disease. Cars get a lot better, airplanes get a lot better, but we're still doing the same old operation. So surgeons, we need to dig in and start to understand this a little bit better. So what came along was this man here, Charles Code. And he passed a tube down the esophagus into the stomach, pulled it back out, and he found that there was a pressure barrier. He called it the high pressure zone in the distal esophagus. And you could see that we got a rise in pressure right at the diaphragm. Here's the gastric pressure, goes up above gastric pressure, and then down into the thoracic cavity where it's subatmospheric pressure. And that was there whether you were sitting or laying down or head down position and so forth. It was always there. And he said there's a high pressure zone that prevents this reflux from occurring. And everybody was quite excited because it was very hard to diagnose people with these ulcers that Xavier Jackson saw. Because symptoms were not a reliable guide to disease. Now we still argue about that today, by the way. But it really is, gastroesophageal reflux is a big masquerader of other diseases. Other disease masquerade is it. And so it's not 100% that you can just sit down and listen to a patient and say, you know, that guy's got gastroesophageal reflux disease. And so it puts the primary care doctor, who has no tools, at a disadvantage, without question about it. So everybody was excited then that they saw this. Because they thought if we just measure this, we will know when people got the disease. They don't have the high pressure zone, they're refluxing, simple. And everybody was excited. So enthusiasm got there, except this guy, McLaurin from England, published in Lancet. Very important publication. By the way, you got to pay $30 to get these publications nowadays. It drives me crazy. But anyway, this was back in 1963. Anything after 1970, I find out you got to pay $30 to get it. I mean, this is really something. I know where they're going on this deal. Anyway, he studied this pressure in great detail. And here's his conclusions. First of all, and look how definitive he was. There is little evidence to support the belief that gastroesophageal reflux is due to the weakness of the intrinsic sphincter at the lower end of the esophagus. Boom. Because he could find people who had the disease without a pressure, and people who didn't have the disease and didn't have a pressure, and so forth. Second, it is concluded that the sphincter is not of primary importance in the prevention of reflux, and there is no direct relationship between the weakness of the sphincter and the development of reflux. Boom. And then he said this is kind of interesting. I never saw this before. This is kind of interesting, this last statement. The compressible intra-abdominal segment of the esophagus acts as a flap valve, is believed to be the main mechanism preventing reflux, and that the internal sphincter assists only by maintaining this segment in a circular fashion. So, of course, the surgeons got all excited about that, and they kept working on their flap valve. All right? But here it is. Here's a sphincter that, as we got a little bit better in technology and so forth. And I'm not going to jump to high resolution. That's a whole nother lecture. But, you know, it doesn't do very well for the sphincter. It was built by internists who are interested in the body of the esophagus. They didn't consult many surgeons because I don't know why. We're few in number, I guess, as to how to analyze the valve, because that's our focus and our interest. So here's it is, and you see there's a nice rise in pressure. So we have a pressure. Most people cover it right here, usually measure it right at the respiratory inversion point where you start having negative compared to positives in the abdomen when you breathe. It switches to negative here. And you see that, then this is where people usually measure the pressure. And the valve has a certain length. It has an abdominal length. Most of it is in the abdomen, and a small amount is in the chest, so you have an overall length. That's the sphincter. So the first thing that had to be done is to solve this problem, why this sphincter is absent in some people, and yet they have the disease, and other people it's present and they have the disease. That was confusing. And that had to wait until 24-hour pH monitoring came out. I mean, I didn't know about that, but I mean, at that time, that when I look back at it, that was really critical. Because what we did in those early days is that we took 1,000 patients, lined them up with their pressure here. This is the pressure. Lined them up if they had a negative 24-hour and a positive 24-hour. All 24-hour pH monitoring did is help us use the hydrogen ion as a tag for the presence of reflux. That's basically all it was. And then we just followed the pressure, potted people with the pressure, and as they started to change, the ratio changed to those who had a positive 24-hour, we could detect that what level pressure of pressure that happened. And here you see statistically about 6 millimeters of mercury, you statistically had more people who had a positive 24-hour, meaning that the pressure of 6 was important. It started down here around 10, but statistically about 6. Now, it makes a lot of sense when you look back at it because the average pressure in the stomach is about 5, 6. So whenever your sphincter pressure got below stomach pressure, it was going to reflux. But it took a while to figure that out. Seems simple now. But keep in mind that this little piece here, it starts down here, but doesn't get statistical down here. So there's a range where that happens. And we looked at the overall length of the sphincter. Overall length of the sphincter, because resistance is pressure over length. And you see here as the sphincter gets shorter, the pressure, the incidence, the ratio of people who have a positive 24-hour starts to go up, and it's about 2. When you get down to 2 statistically, when your sphincter goes from 4 to 2, chances are you're going to reflux. And then we looked at the abdominal length, which is the length that's kind of responds to abdominal pressure. It happened again, the same thing. You see that as the length gets shorter, you get down to about 1 centimeter, and then the efficiency breaks off, and you start having reflux. Now, so this allowed us to identify a structurally defective sphincter in a patient and know when it would fail. And it was basically any one of these criteria, pressure less than 6, overall length less than 2, or an abdominal length less than 1. Now, another thing that we understood at that time, we started to see that this was a gradual loss. Sometimes, if you had a pressure, bad overall length, and bad abdominal length, 92% of those patients would have a positive test. And then there were variabilities. So just pressure and abdomen, about 88% abdominal length. If you just had, say, an overall length, reduced an overall length, 76%. So there was a variety. As these defects accumulated, you would have a bigger chance of having a defective sphincter. If all three were gone, it was pretty much 100%. And so we now understood how this sphincter worked a little bit in the sense of its structure. But we never knew how we got there, why this sphincter started to deteriorate. Now, the other conundrum that was is that half the people that were refluxing had a normal sphincter. And about half the people who reflux, we can measure a defect in the sphincter. And as I said, if that defect got quite dramatic, three components of it being defective, it was a really bad sphincter. So that was the next question that had to be solved to understand where we can go with surgical science. Now, there was an explanation for that. And the explanation for that is that these people who had a normal sphincter reflux because of a phenomenon that Jerry Dodds, a citizen of this state, down in Milwaukee, discovered these transient sphincter relaxations. And what those are, for those of you who don't know, here's the pressure in the lower esophageal sphincter. Here's the esophageal baseline, pharynx. This is pH up here, and this is stomach. Very quiescent esophagus. And suddenly, there the sphincter would relax. Now, normally, when we swallow, the sphincter is told to relax, and it relaxes. But it's not supposed to relax when you don't swallow. And these things would happen without a swallow. A very quiescent esophagus. And as soon as you had that little relaxation, you might get reflux, and as a consequence, your esophageal body would start to contract to clear it. And these were called transient sphincter relaxations. I didn't like the name. I knew Jerry Dodds well. He passed away as a young man from a brain tumor. But we used to talk about this. And I said, Jerry, it's not fair to call them transient sphincter relaxations, because relaxations imply a mechanism. Why don't you just say transient sphincter losses or something like that? But, I guess relaxations, it's okay. But, it changes your mind a little bit. Puts you in a little different focus. And that's the problem. That's the problem with a lot of our science, is we use words to push people in one direction or another. And this is what he proposed. Now, when you go deeper, now, the event was measurable. And it's a definite discovery, no question about it. It's the explanation that's the problem. And what Jerry Dodds thought, and others, John Dent, so forth, what they said is that as the stomach is distended, there are stretch receptors in the fundus that go up the vagus into the medulla, organized and come back down the vagus to the lower esophageal sphincter and stimulate it electrically. As a consequence, the sphincter opens. It's a reflex phenomenon. There's not been a lot of support, and I've read all the literature in this area. It's hard to show that. But it's been responsible for millions of dollars of research looking for a drug like baclofen and others that will interfere with this. The other here's the dynamic aspect of it that really kind of supported it. Here's this event. This is done by a fellow from Rotterdam, and he put a balloon in the stomach, and he would then put pressure in that balloon, and as he increased the pressure in the stomach, the number of these transient sphincter relaxations would go up, and as he deflated it, they'd go down. If he measured volume the same way, if he put more volume in and took the volume out, the number of these transient sphincter relaxations would go up and down. And it sort of thought, well, you're stimulating a sensor, and it's happening through a reflex event. He also did another interesting thing. That, what I showed you first, was distimulation with pressure. What he did then is did this ingenious experiment. Here is the intragastric volume in that bag that he put in. This is time, and this is the transient sphincter relaxation rate here. So he put this bag in the stomach with no pressure, just keeping the bag at the non-distensible pressure of about 2 millimeters of mercury. So then he fed the patient around the bag. So as the patient is fed with this liquid meal, the stomach starts to expand, called adaptive relaxation. You've heard about it. Adaptive relaxation, the stomach starts to expand. That's why you can enjoy your meals and so forth. And in order to keep the bag at this normal volume but same pressure, he had to infuse air. And so you can see the amount of air that's being infused as the stomach dilates up, and then gradually it empties and goes back. Now, when it gets dilated, without pressure, adaptive relaxation occurring, the number of transient sphincter relaxations go up. It gets a little bit more. Now, I say, well, Jerry, we got adaptive relaxation going on in our stomach, and that's stimulating disease? It's a little funny. But that's one explanation for why people will reflux with a normal sphincter. Now, this is what we know about transient sphincter relaxations today. Number one, they're no more frequent in patients than in normal people. The reflux is no different. But the only thing different is not all of them are associated with reflux. Well, it's a little weak. And when they occur in GERD patients, they're twice as likely to be associated with reflux. So there's something about GERD patients that allows reflux to occur more commonly than in normal people, but the number of these things are the same in patients as they are in normals. They're stimulated by balloon distension of the fundus. They're stimulated by a meal-induced gastric adaptive relaxation, as I told you, without pressure. And the mechanism by which they occur is not real convincing yet. Now, on the other side, there was another proposal, and that is that these were caused by transient shortening of the LES. What we mean here is that as you distend the stomach, you will see that the sphincter starts to efface and get shorter. And you keep distending the stomach, you'll get to the point where the sphincter opens as it gets shortened and reflux occurs. The prevention of reflux is really pressure over length, which is resistance. As you shorten the length, the pressure can't hold it and gives way. So that was studied in some detail in our laboratory. We liked this explanation because it fit with a surgeon. A surgeon could do something about that. It can't do too much about reflex. And here is what happens when you... This is volume. This is overall length of the sphincter. And this is putting this air into the stomach on normal people. And you see what happens is as you distend the stomach, the length of the sphincter gets shorter. In fact, quite a few of them get below the critical 2-centimeter length, which is usually associated with a positive 24 hours in normal people. So this phenomenon really works. This shows this is pre and post insufflation in these people that were studied, and everybody shortens their sphincter to some degree. So it's a phenomenon that isn't just maybe you shorten, you all shorten, just different, varies to the different degree that people shorten, and that's probably related to the amount of air that's in the stomach or the size of the stomach. By the way, when you eat a meal, it's about 750 cc's that you can tolerate. If you homogenize your meal, it's about 750 cc's. If you eat more than that, you're going to shorten your sphincter pretty hard, and you're going to say, oh, man, I ate the whole darn thing. And you don't feel real good. That's why we have postprandial heartburn. Basically, that's why I have it. So this relationship is the overall length to the pressure. Now, it's a pressure ratio, the ratio between gastric pressure and sphincter pressure. let's say gastric pressure 6 and sphincter pressure 6, the ratio is 1. If you have a sphincter 5 centimeters long, perfect. It's okay. That's why, by the way, when you do a colon position, make sure there's 5 centimeters in the abdomen. Keeps you from refluxing. See how much, if you start knowing this stuff, you can be a much better surgeon. And so if I say we double the pressure, let's take the gastric pressure 6, but make sphincter pressure 12, or so it's 2, then you need 3 centimeters of sphincter to remain competent. And you can go up to 3 times, make it 18, and the sphincter pressure 18 and this 6, you got to have 2 centimeters. But when you start getting up there around 20 and so forth, you got to get that high in your ratio. To make your ratio, you start losing because your length is so short, you can't make it happen. And so you're incompetent when you fall in these areas. It's that relationship that's critical. Now, how does that get us to reflux disease? And what you see here is having a scope in the stomach, turning it around and distending the stomach. And gastroenterologists do this all the time, and most of you who do endoscopy, you can do this yourself. The key thing is that you see effacement occur. Here's the sphincter. I mean, here's the gastroesophageal junction. And it's effacing into the fundus as you fill your stomach. Now, I want you to see here that this is a very irregular squamocolumnar junction. And that's because as this is exposed with effacement, this is getting acted upon by gastric juices. And right here you can see a little bit of ulceration. And probably the sphincter was initially like this, a nice clean one, but it's been eaten up because of effacement. And if you biopsy right there, you'll find cardiac epithelium, which is a healing epithelium. Metaplastic epithelium that occurs when you try to heal squamous epithelium in the presence of an acid environment. Now, what that's led to is a concept that a lot of people don't understand. And if you get this concept, you'll be miles ahead. The real junction at the squamocolumnar junction is, here's squamous cell epithelium, and right here is oxyntic epithelium. Oxyntic epithelium means fundic epithelium, gastric epithelium, which has got parietal cells in it. Okay? It's a bang-bang right next to each other. That's normal. What happens when here's the squamocolumnar, this gets effaced into the stomach, and here you see the oxyntic mucosa, and this here is cardiac mucosa. And it's metaplastic mucosa filling in where you ate up your esophagus when you effaced. Now, when that happens, it kills the sphincter muscle. And gradually, your sphincter gets shortened. And pretty soon, it's only 3 centimeters long instead of 3.5 to 4, and it can't hold any gastric distension as much as it did before. Now, a lot of people, you know, you can start to appreciate this if you look at this. Here's another. I got these from Jeff Peters. He sent them, and I thought they were really good. Here you see, this is looking back at this sphincter retrograde, and here you see what you might think is the squamocolumnar junction. However, if you use narrow band imaging, you see trappings of squamous epithelium way out here. So see, right here is really the squamocolumnar junction at one time. You won't recognize it if you look at it just like this. It's right in here. All this is not stomach. All that is esophagus. esophagus that's lost its tone because it's been destroyed with a replacement of cardiac epithelium. And as a consequence, the sphincter's getting shorter. Now, this really screws up a lot of people because, you see, we look for what we start to look at this, and we could use that as a landmark to place Bravo PH catheter. And look at how far away you are from the real junction. Or this doesn't have Rugal folds in it. This can have Rugal folds even developing in here because it's on its way to become stomach, basically. If you leave it alone and don't horse around with it, it will become oxyntocardiac mucosa. It's cardiac mucosa in an acid environment which starts to have parietal cells. It's moving towards gastric epithelium. And so the esophagus is becoming part of the stomach. And it gets us all confused. It even got Barrett confused, right? We're just narrowing it down to about this level nowadays because it's closer, but it gets us confused. And GI guys are still measuring. They're not taking attention to this at all. They still measure the GE junction like that. Look at the top of the Rugal folds. Top of the Rugal folds is where they think, and I love the GI guys if I'm getting after you a little bit. I don't know if you're here or not, but they think is where the stomach stops and the esophagus starts. It's based on four cases. Four cases, if you look at the original publication on it by Worth Boyce. It's just doesn't make sense. So you got to start putting this together and understand it. Now, so, and on top of that, there's been a whole development of the understanding of the acid pocket. Now, this is 21st century stuff you got to have in your mind now. This is the acid pocket. Confused the living daylights out of us, but now it's really there. This was done by a fellow in Glasgow, McColl. He said, you know, there's a pocket right here underneath in the upper part of the stomach that's acid. And it's there all the time. Even after you eat, almost a little bit during your eating. And it's an interesting phenomenon, even if you got a hiatal hernia, it's there. And you got to understand a little bit about this acid pocket. It probably is there as a defense mechanism probably for us. We eat a lot of food. A lot of food is contaminated. Hydrochloric acid just knocks the living daylights out of bacteria. So maybe that's the reason. And, of course, you know, if you're on PPIs, the high incidence of, you know, GI disease and when you go to a foreign country or so forth and so on. So it's acid pockets there. Now, I think McColl published a really neat illustration of this. And I just want to take you through this because this is fascinating. He had several pH catheters in the stomach. And so red is passing from the stomach esophagus. This is esophagus. Here's the GE junction. This is the stomach. And these are the different pH levels based on color. 2, 4, 6, and 8. Here we are before a meal. The esophagus is 8. The GE junction is about 6. And the stomach is 2. Then you start eating the meal. And you see when you eat the meal, here it comes down. Most of our food is not real acidic. It's more on the line of weakly acid. And here you see the change to about a pH of 6 in the stomach. Now, you notice that the pH of 2 is gone. Now, during the meal, you start to see the pH of 2 come back, right where the acid pocket is. Here's the esophagus. And pretty soon it gets pretty strong. Acid is forming on top of your food. And actually, here you see, after the meal, you see reflux occurring up into the esophagus. And then, of course, after the meal here, things settle down. You still have this very broad band of acid, even while the remaining portion of the meal is in the stomach and gradually being emptied. It's there all the time. This slide shows the subcardial pH. This is the mean pH for the whole 24-hour period in patients here. This is people, healthy volunteers is this. These are patients without a hiatal hernia. These are patients with a hiatal hernia. You see the mean pH throughout the 24-hour period is below 2 in the subcardial area, in the area of the acid pocket. If you look at it 2 hours after a meal, standardized meal, they did a standardized meal, it's about 3. If you look at it and without a standardized meal 2 hours afterwards, you see it's still about 3. If you look at the percent time, the pH is less than 4, almost 80 to 100% of the time, the pH down there is less than 4. So the acid pocket is a phenomenal thing. And so when you efface your sphincter because you fill your stomach up too much, you're exposing it to the acid pocket. And it's no wonder it eats up the squamous epithelium and produces cardiac epithelium, which is the first stage of Barrett's. Now, this comes from Fox. He's a good guy. He's a GI guy. I love him. He's a wonderful guy in London, England. And he's on the same kick a little bit. And what he's shown, this is age. He made this idea. He said, look, if you're an older person, you probably had GERD longer than if you're younger. This is a supposition you have to kind of believe when you look at this graph. Here is this is abdominal length. So when you're 30 years old and you had reflux disease, very short period of time, you've got a pretty good abdominal length. Look what happens to your abdominal length as you get older, presumably because you had reflux disease longer. And right with that, parallel with that, the esophageal acid exposure of the esophagus going up. Very interesting graph. What makes it even more interesting, if you took people that didn't have acid exposure, in other words, they don't have the disease, there was no change in this at all. You kept the same length, and you kept the same acid exposure compared to a person who had reflux disease. So we're beginning to see, and the data is developing, that we're eating away the bottom of our sphincter with this effacement, the shortening that occurs. If we eat too much of it, we're going to get more transient sphincter relaxations with reflux, and we're replacing it with cardiac epithelium, which can become, over a period of time, if we don't treat it right, it can become intestinal metaplasia. And this is accounting for what I call the gradual progression of the squamocolumnar junction upwards. Now, this is done by Sendez. Very interesting guy, does a lot of interesting things, and he's graded his esophagitis across here, and Barrett, this is Barrett's in here. He's got a special classification for it, but it's okay. And what he's marking here now is the position of the squamocolumnar junction to the upper border of the LES. Here's the upper border of the LES. And he says, down here, most of us have our squamocolumnar junction within our LES. Then over time, with reflux disease, it starts creeping towards at the upper border, and then it goes even up into the esophagus and so forth. So there's a gradual progression of the squamocolumnar junction upward. And with that gradual progression, you see what happens to the sphincter. It gets shorter. Gets shorter over time. Of course, when we get up to here, we have Barrett's. There's another picture from another continent, from another investigator, showing the same phenomenon. And it doesn't surprise you that when you start looking at reflux disease, no injury, esophagitis, stricture, and Barrett's, as you go up here, the structurally defective sphincter gets more and more common. So gradually, as you're refluxing and effacing and refluxing and eating up the lower portion of the esophagus, the sphincter, you're starting to destroy it, and when you get up to Barrett's, it's all gone. Anybody that's got a Barrett's of about over 3 centimeters, maybe 4, 5, 6 centimeters, pretty much is all gone. And so I kind of put it together this way. I call it creeping carditis. Here we are normal. We start to erode at the bottom here because of effacing. And we put cardiac mucosa there. We dig into the sphincter more and more over time. The disease is confined to the sphincter. Not much is getting up in the esophagus because the sphincter's still a little bit there yet. Finally, the sphincter gives way more commonly. You start having the disease explode in the esophagus, and then you have Barrett's. By the way, that accounts for why a lot of people have different symptoms. If you listen carefully to your patients with reflux disease, it usually starts with a little epigastric pain. And it doesn't really have heartburn and all this stuff. It comes when the sphincter gets shortened more and more. When it's challenged with gastric distension, shortens it even more. And reflux occurs, you start having heartburn postprandially. But the disease actually starts quite a ways before that. So we took this to the lab and just really checked this in baboons. We got this theory and we got all this together. So we want to check this in baboons where we can control things. And baboons are, you know, somewhat like people, I guess. So here is the length of the sphincter. Here is the intergastric volume. And you can see that as the sphincter gets shorter, as the volume gets more, the sphincter gets shorter. Just like I showed you that occurred in humans. As the volume in the stomach increases, the sphincter gets shorter. If you look at the time of transient sphincter relaxations or loss of the barrier, opening of the sphincter, whatever you want to call it, as you get the sphincter shorter, the number of transient sphincter openings or common cavities, as you might call it, as it gets shorter, it gets greater. You get down to the magic number of 2, the thing's opening quite commonly. Makes sense. It fits together with the theories. Now here was a startling observation. That was that here again I showed you, here's the sphincter length, here's the volume. As the volume increases, the sphincter length gets shorter, just like I showed you. But here's what happens after a Nissen fundoplication. It doesn't happen. The Nissen prevents the sphincter from getting shortened when the stomach is effaced. When the stomach is distended, it can't efface the sphincter. We didn't expect that. By the way, Rudolf Nissen didn't know anything about what we're talking about. He was just lucky. He was just lucky that it worked. And if you look at the number of TLSERs before fundoplication of the baboons and after fundoplication, you almost got rid of all. That's why the Nissen works for whether you got a good sphincter or a bad sphincter. Good sphincter, it stops shortening. Bad sphincter, it reconstructs the length of the sphincter and so forth. But there was a sharp little guy. He worked for, this was when I was in Chicago, a sharp little guy worked for Tom Bumbeck. And we used to have a kind of cooperative thing between our laboratories. And he said, do you really need to have a fundoplication to do that? So what he did is he put this little loose ligature here, and he distended the stomach, and he found out that when he did that, this didn't occur, and that didn't happen. And here's his study. This is gastric volume. This is pressure of the sphincter. You see gastric volume increases the pressure in the stomach. This is a normal sphincter. And you see as the volume gets up to about 750 cc's, the sphincter opens and pressure equalizes. The reflux occurs from effacement. But he puts that little ligature, that loose ligature, and the sphincter doesn't open. It can't be effaced until you get out to close to 2,000 cc's. You know, we looked at that and we said, hey, it's pretty interesting. But who's going to tie off the esophagus? Even if it's a loose ligature, you won't be able to eat. So then, I want to now take that technology and apply it to modern care. Now that what we know, care in the 21st century. And what we have to do together with the GI guys is we need to attack this disease. We need to attack this disease. We need to go to war against this disease together. We have to have an ally. We got to get an ally together and start going to war against this disease so that we can change this 30% increase every 10 years. So let's attack the fundamental determinants of reflux disease. They are the lower esophageal sphincter and the composition of the gastroesophageal reflux, or juice, gastric juice. Now let's look where we are a little bit so we can see why we need a change. Now this is Sir Black. He won the Nobel Prize for what we call rational drug design. What he did is he says, listen, and we're getting all our drugs from all these leaves and plants and extracts and so forth. Why don't we take the technology we know of chemistry, study an event just like I did physiologically here with you. Let's study an event chemically. Let's understand how the parietal cell makes acid and gets it out into the stomach. And then let's design in our laboratory a compound that will exactly interrupt that. And he did the same thing for heart disease, same kind of thought process. And he came up with two drugs, and you know about propranolol and cimetidine. First two drugs to exceed $1 billion in sales, very effective. And this led to the PPI discovery, and it improved the symptoms of reflux disease better than we as surgeons could do. I mean, can you believe it? When I first started, all the GI guys had was Maalox. We won without any trouble at all. You look at the randomized study in the New England Journal by Behov, you'll see it. You know, we just won hands down. But when they got this drug, we had to work a little harder. And it virtually eliminated all the acid-induced problems. We don't get much esophagitis strictures or giant Barrett's ulcers. Most of you probably never seen a giant Barrett's ulcer. We used to see a lot of them, big ones in the esophagus. But, there were two failures in just using PPIs. Took us 30 years to understand this. The first failure is the data on sustained resolution of heartburn. Now, this was known when they discovered PPIs. This was known. But we didn't hear much about it. Well, we were sold, and properly so, I think, that this was a very effective drug to stop esophagitis. Healing rates is what sold this drug on the market. Not sustained release, resolution of symptoms. Here you see two drugs studied here for sustained release of symptoms based on diary, and you see there's about a 30% gap between 100% sustained and 70%. It didn't take care of the symptoms as much as it took care of the esophagitis. And so it's no surprise after 30 years that people are not fully satisfied with PPIs. Now everybody that's a GI guy is going to tell, oh, they love it, Tom, it's so forth, it's just wonderful, it's, you don't have to worry about. And you know, if they talk to me about Nissens, I say, oh, they love it, they don't have to worry about it. We all have our bias. The human mind is so adept at protecting its own ideas and its bias that we don't listen all the time. So this now is a factor that we have observed in the last 30 years. We also observed the other failure is that we now have data that we do not affect the sphincter at all with the PPIs. And you've seen this data. You all know about it, I think. This is off PPIs. This is on PPIs. This is the number of reflux episodes that are total number of reflux episodes. These are those that are acid, and these are those that are weak acid. So when you're off PPIs, most are acid, a few are weak acid, the total is here. When you're on PPIs, you still have the same total. You just change the pH. These are acid, these are weak acid. You just kind of seesaw these together here. You don't really stop the reflux episode. So one part of the attack is not working. We're not dealing with a sphincter. We're dealing with a gastric juice, but we're not dealing with a sphincter. So when we kind of look at this, 20 million people are on PPIs. I think it's a very, very realistic number. Most people say it's 30, maybe 40 million. But I think there's 20 million people on PPIs that are reasonably accurately for them to be on. Prescriptions for double dose PPIs have increased over 50% over the past 7 years. What's happening? They need to treat people with higher doses. Why? Sphincters failing. Of the patients on PPI supplement their prescriptions. Why? As time goes on, the sphincter is failing, it's harder to keep asymptomatic. 30% of patients are dissatisfied. Why? Because it doesn't give sustained release because the sphincter is failing with symptoms. PPIs do not prevent progression of the disease. PPIs do not prevent metaplastic or dysplastic complications of the disease. PPIs have significant side effects. That's where we are today. So it's not a colossal success. It's a success, but it's not 100%. And we're losing because every 10 years, the incidence of this disease increases by 30%. And every year, the complications of this disease go up. And they're devastating complications. So the patient, where is he nowadays in 2014? He said, well, you know, I can have persistent symptoms despite my therapy. I got a lifelong dependency on this. There's disease progression while I'm on it. Side effects of the medication and surgery, there's side effects in both. And if I get this Nissen fundoplication, it's very final because if it doesn't work, the redos aren't as good. And there's a fairly high instance of them falling apart. So what does this mean for me in the long run? There was this fellow, Todd Berg, who's an engineer, used to be a cardiovascular engineer, came out with a couple that worked for St. Jude and got a little upset with the way they were marketing their devices and so forth, and he left the company. He went to Silicon Valley, got some grants to study reflux disease, and he spent 2 years holed up in his office looking at reports after reports and reports, and he looked specifically at surgical therapy. And he noted that the Nissen did increase and improve a defective sphincter. Here is pre-op resting pressure, controls. This is pre-op and this is post-op. Brought it back to normal levels. Overall length, controls, pre-op, post-op. Abdominal length, controls, pre-op, and post-op. The Nissen could do that. By the way, again, Rudolf Nissen had no idea he was doing this. He was just making a flap valve, and he was just lucky that it worked out this way. And, of course, with that, he's got competency back because 24-hour pH improved. But there were side effects. Now, I know your Nissens have no side effects. I know your patients don't complain of this at all, but mine do. Mine do. This is several of our stuff here, what we did with Peters and Delamage, who did the first Nissens. And this is Lars Lindell's studies. Look at the incidence of inability to belch, inability to vomit, increased flatus, gas bloat, persistent dysphagia. We got side effects. Ours, as surgeons, is not perfect either. And if you really listen to your patients, you'll understand that. And if you can kind of disconnect yourself from your bias, you'll make a step forward. And what was interesting is when we look back over our data, if we did people who had a dynamic failure, that is a normal sphincter, but were refluxing, we call that dynamic failure of the sphincter, compared to people who have a permanent or structurally defective sphincter because it's been destroyed, if you do a Nissen on these people, you have a much higher incidence of these two complications versus those who are destroyed. So if you put a Nissen on a person who's got a good sphincter but is refluxing, it's overkill. It's overkill. It's not so great here either, but it does a job, but you pay for it too. But it's more so if you get it on someone that's early disease. So when you look at surgical therapy in 2014, what you see is that there's a mortality rate to it, small, but there is a mortality rate to it. There's no mortality to medicine. Major complications of 6%, consisting of perforation, hemorrhage, or splenic injury. Reoperation is 0 to 15%, more like 15% reoperation rate. Outcome, durability, and need for revision is based on surgeon's ability and experience, and the internist will tell you about that. Significant side effects, inability to belch, vomit, abdominal bloating, flatulence, diarrhea, temporary and permanent dysphagia. Not endorsed by the GI community, not endorsed by the patient. So after all these years, since 1950 when the Nissen started to take popularity, we aren't doing so good either. In fact, the curtain call on surgery. This was by Vakil. You notice this is at 1 to 5, pages 1 to 5. That means it's the first article of the journal. This was coming out in 2003. Vakil's from just down the road here, down in Milwaukee. This is 80 patients, follow up from about 20 plus. Minus 10 months. And this is the effectiveness of laparoscopic fundoplication in the community. Completely satisfied people, 61%, somewhat 24, somewhat dissatisfied, very dissatisfied. New symptoms in 67%, gas, bloating, dysphagia. Restart acid suppression therapy in 32%. And you wonder why the number of Nissens went down? Following this article, it just went down like ever. So we're not doing so good. So Todd said after he studied this, we've got to have a new surgical procedure that's safe, elegantly simple, effective, minimally disruptive, ability to standardize, free side effects, and reversible. That's what you really need. And so he took what Samuelson did with that loose ligature and put it a circle of beads, magnetic beads, around the lower portion of the lower esophageal sphincter to act as a loose ligature to prevent effacement. And then he stopped effacement with that, and he stopped opening of the sphincter. It's about this big as a ring. These are the little beads. When they're together, they make a Roman arch so that they don't compress on tissue but on each other. They can expand up to a 60 French. All they do is you place them around the lower part of the sphincter. You do not take down the phrenoesophageal membrane. No wonder we take down the phrenoesophageal membrane with a Nissen and we get 15% reduce. We can't put that back together like it was. Stays away from that. That keeps our abdominal esophagus there. When you look at the outcome of this, this is reduction of esophageal acid exposure over three different publications. You see down means down to normal. This is normal. If you look at the median symptom score, dramatically down in these three publications, quite a bit the same in different publications from different units. Reduction of regurgitation, that's a sphincter symptom, by the way. Because if you got a bad sphincter, you regurgitate, just takes care of that. Discontinuation of PPIs. Patient satisfaction. No one's satisfied before surgery. About 90%, 95% satisfaction. All these are three different articles. Median side effects at 48 months, 36 months, and 36 months, zero dysphagia. Ability to belch, ability to vomit. Median quality of life. Here is where people were on PPIs before, off PPIs before. Here where they were on PPIs, here they are off PPIs 3 years later after a Lynx procedure. So you get some steadfast, but you can improve beyond what you can get with PPIs. This is satisfaction with their current position. Very few people were satisfied. Most people are satisfied afterwards. We do have dysphagia. Dysphagia occurs whenever you manipulate the esophagus. It's temporary. It takes a little while to get over it. But about 65% of people will say they got some little problem getting swallowing it. They don't, that means they can eat, but they have a little dysphagia. But it does clear over a period of time as the thing gets seated in. We also start everybody on a preoperative diet. I mean, on a postoperative diet. It's not a diet. It's normal. We want them to swallow regular food. That's why they get a little bit more dysphagia, because we want to exercise the device. It's like a tendon thing. You want to exercise it so that you don't get a scar tissue buildup and prevent it from moving. It's a very safe procedure. This is... This is in the first 1,000 patients that were implanted. Here is the number of implanting centers, quite a few centers, 86, 82. Duration up to 2,000 days. Here you see complication, really, perioperative complications is zero. Conversion rate is zero. Readmission rate is 1%. Dilatation was 6%. Device removal, we removed it for an MRI, or some people want to have it out. The dysphagia was a little bit too much, so we took it out. 6%. Device erosion, we had 1% erosion. The way we calculate it should be less than 1%. This is 0.1%. And device migration, zero. So it's an extremely safe procedure. I mean, it's much more safer than injecting bulking agents in the sphincter. Now, I want to close by just saying, how does that fit then in the 21st century? We have got a war on Barrett's. People are starting to ablate it. They're trying to get rid of that pre-malignant condition. But what we really need to do is stop the progression of the disease. That's what we need to do. Because this disease progresses from non-erosive GERD to stuff that heals pretty nicely to persistent esophagitis that has difficult to heal to Barrett's. There is a movement in this direction over a long period of time, 2 to 16 years. Here's a good example of what I'm talking about. This is from Klaus. This is a group of patients that were looked at from symptom recurrence or esophagitis. They were on a full dose of PPI for 12 months. Here's what happens when you have a normal sphincter and you go on PPIs, you see the recurrence rate is very low. But if you have a defective sphincter, you get up to about 30%, just about where that where the sustained 30% gap is in symptom control. Of course, if you get defective body and LES, it's even worse. That's where you're getting into Barrett's. Showing that the use of PPIs has to be related to the sphincter. Good functioning sphincter, better control of PPIs. Here's one of Elliot Klinkenberg's, probably the most carefully controlled group of people over 10 years. You see there's dose escalation here, particularly up to 60 milligrams a day with time. As the sphincter deteriorates, you've got to increase the dose. Here's what happens during her study. 12% incidence of Barrett's developing during the study. Here is the ProGERD study, something that every surgeon should read. 2,000 patients followed for 5 years in Germany. Of those patients, 10% moved on to Barrett's over the 5 years. Predictors were family history, esophagitis at baseline, unhealed esophagitis after the initial therapy, alcohol use, and taking PPIs regularly, which is interesting. If you take PPIs intermittently or on demand, the risk for cancer is less, which is kind of interesting for progression. So GERD is a chronic progressive disease. So what we have to do is look for flags of progression. You put people on PPIs and it's starting to get less effective. They start saying to you, hey, doc, this stuff isn't as good as it used to be. Or I'm not comfortable like I was before. Progression. Sphincter's starting to fail. Nocturnal symptoms. You know, I got to sleep up, you know, with several pillows. I'm getting into trouble. I don't sleep well. Wake up coughing, sometimes choking. Regurgitation up to the pharynx. Start saying, I never used to eat. Now it comes right up in the back of my pharynx. It's loud. Those are all symptoms that your sphincter is failing. There's some signs of it too. Bipositional refluxers. They start out supine or upright refluxers and they go bipositional. Their sphincter is going. By the way, if you do a Bravo study on them and they are abnormal both days, if you do for 48 hours, Bravo, 48 hours, Bravo, if they're abnormal both days, chances are the sphincter's bad, about 90%. If they're just abnormal one of the 2 days, the sphincter's not too bad. There's variability in their symptoms, you see. And if they have more than one component of their sphincter, then they're starting to fail. That is, if they got a low pressure, if they got a low short length, or one of those is a sign the sphincter's failing. So in those people, we need to do a procedure like the LINX, something really simple, doesn't add side effects. Now, just look at this a minute, and I'll finish. The number of GERD patients in the U.S., I think, is 20,000 on PPIs. I just kind of said, I think that's a very fair number. According to the ProGERD study, Elliot Klinkenberg and other people, the number that progressed to Barrett's in 5 years is about 10%. That's 2 million people. The number of people that are going from here that are going to go to cancer is 0.1%, 0.5% per year. So over 5 years, that's 2.5%. That's 50,000 people. 50,000. Even if we could reduce that by half by improving the sphincter, we could reduce the number of people getting cancer to 25,000. Now, let me tell you, this country went to war over 3,000 lives in a tower that came down. We ought to go to war against this disease when we're losing 25,000 people or 50,000 people. It's incumbent upon us to do that. So, start thinking in the 21st century. Medication for early disease. Signs of progression. LINX. Real advanced disease, destroyed sphincter, Nissen. That's going to be the 21st century's treatment of GERD. And I think will make a difference in what this disease is doing to our patients if we're serious. So we should get together and make this happen. Thank you very much.